there's a new boogeyman, Joseph Kony, worse than Iraqi WMDs. Give up all your rights, launch big wars, it's peace.
Whether or not we would want to get permission from the Congress, I think those are issues we would have to discuss as we decide what to do here.
Well, I'm almost breathless about that, because what I heard you say is we're going to seek international approval, and they will come and tell the Congress what we might do, and we might seek congressional approval.
Oh! Special forces attacks.
Put my constitutional law professor hat on here. Do I think that our actions in any way violate the War Powers Resolution? The answer is no. So I don't even have to get to the constitutional question.
Simply, sir, what's your reaction?
That's a horrible statement.
And he's got a Odinga Islamic alliance to crush the Christians in Kenya, but this also reaches into Ethiopia, it reaches into Uganda, Congo, Tanzania, and a whole bunch of other countries in that region. So all of Africa is a battlefield in flames between the U.S. and the Chinese, with Obama leading the charge to kick the Chinese out.
Well, in the last 3 days, I've seen 37 million views of Kony 2012. And everybody's saying, man, Alex, you got to get behind a war, an invasion in the middle of Africa. I mean, after all, the children are being enslaved. And there's a group called Invisible Children that wants to have a military invasion against Joseph Kony, who I've researched for years, there in Uganda. Well, there's a problem here. I've looked into Joseph Kony years ago. He's obviously another warmonger bad guy. But the actual president of Uganda has been involved in genocides of over 7 million people. And best I can tell, Joseph Kony might have a couple thousand followers, 200 to 400, max 500 soldiers. Maybe 100,000 they've killed in a couple decades. I mean, the point is, he's like Saddam beat the brains out of babies in incubators in Kuwait. They admit that's PR, wasn't true. Or they've got this Syrian guy who they're saying there's all these massacres. That's now admitted to be fake. Or you've got the claim that Gaddafi's people were racing around raping women fueled by Viagra. Wasn't true. And they admit that 40,000 plus people are dead, including most of them black Africans in Libya, and that they're using al-Qaeda there. And in Syria, the West doesn't want to bring liberty to Syria. They want to destabilize that country and use al-Qaeda to do it. This is all on record. And I know about Rwanda. I know about the Hutus and the Tutsis. I know about what's happening in Uganda. I've researched this. And I predicted with my guests and researchers in the Obama deception 3.5 years ago that they would invade Libya, that they would invade Uganda, that they would go after all of these different organizations. And that has now happened. That has now happened with the Lord's Resistance Army, all of it. They sent in special forces last year trying to kill them. So remember, when the West and the corrupt interests that run this country say they want to invade an area to stop a human rights disaster, I have examples from just last year in the Ivory Coast of Africa, where they admit that the UN killed tens of thousands of people to overthrow the elected government there in the Ivory Coast. So we've seen this over and over again. Just last April, close to a year ago, the UN on record was backing rebels, attacking the government and killing tens of thousands, mainly Christians. But don't worry, the BBC said the UN would investigate that. And then Obama launched his own attack in Uganda in Central Africa. My point is, the people controlling our society could care less about human rights events or violations or genocide. In fact, they're funding it. And when I saw the group Invisible Children with all these movie stars and all these groups come out with basically a pro-war, pro-invasion call, and their film got 37 million views in just 3 or 4 days, and I saw the State Department behind it and all this propaganda and members of Congress pushing it, I knew that something was going on, just like the babies in the incubators, all of it. This has nothing to do with actually trying to help people there. Am I saying that the group they want to fight is good? No. But what I'm saying is we hear about this 2012 movement against Kony, and it's nothing but using him as a convenient boogeyman when he's a minor player in the overall larger system as a pretext to invade these countries. And I've had young people, a lot of my young listeners, who are waking up but are still somewhat naive. They're being shown this in public school. They're calling me. They're saying, they're hurting children. They're enslaving children. We've got to get behind war. And the biggest issue here is the system is using the foundation-controlled left and the normal avenues that are promoting anti-war now as a pro-war activism and a pro-war hysteria, and that's what this is, and it's being promoted by the system to invade and take over Central Africa and also invade out of Libya and North Africa. AFRICOM. All of this was predicted in my film released 3.5 years ago, The Obama Deception. Let's go ahead and go to a clip of that before we go to Webster Tarpley.
Obama basically does a couple of things. One is, again, this idea, kick the Chinese out of Africa. Kick them out of Sudan where they get oil. Kick them out of Zimbabwe where they get raw materials. Start a civil war in Congo, another big source of raw materials. Al-Qaeda, an arm of the U.S. intelligence community, is now active in Algeria, Tunisia, Morocco. You've got a destabilization going on in Kenya around Odinga. That's Obama's cousin. This is a guy who has two children. They're Obama's niece and, nephew in a broad sense. And one of them is named Raul, and the other one is named Winnie, after Winnie Mandela, who did the necklacing and political assassinations in South Africa. So this Odinga is essentially a CIA destabilizing operation in Kenya, and he's got a Odinga Islamic alliance to crush the Christians in Kenya. But this also reaches into Ethiopia, it reaches into Uganda, Congo, Tanzania, and a whole bunch of other countries in that region. So all of Africa is a battlefield in flames between the U.S. and the Chinese, with Obama leading the charge to kick the Chinese out for geopolitical reasons.
Now, again, the establishment has the controlled neocon right calling for war, the controlled left, George Clooney, all of them. We've got to invade Sudan. They're attacking the Christians while the U.N.'s actually slaughtering them. We've got to invade Uganda so they can have the Muslim groups kill the Christian groups that are rebels. There's all sorts of barbarism going on here. But I had a caller when Obama was just president-elect, before he was even in office in January of 2009, who called in and broke it all down, that Obama is just the African face on this neo-colonial imperialism. Again, I want to stop genocide. I'm for the little guy. But when I see a big Hollywood-financed movement lecturing everyone that we've got to have an invasion and all of the regular peace groups calling for war, we know about the State Department using Twitter and Facebook. We know this is their new model, getting the swarming adolescents involved in all of this. Let's go to that clip of the caller.
They put the face of Barack Obama as part of their public relations because it's like the old folk tales about vampires. A vampire cannot force his way into somebody's house. It's against some kind of metaphysical law. So the vampire has to persuade the resident of the household to open the door and invite him in. So they're going to look at the peephole at Barack Obama, which looks like them and appears to be on their side. They're going to say, okay, here's my ally. Let me open the door and let me let this person in. And then Barack Obama is just, of course, a front man for the American empire, where he's going to have the entire U.S. Navy, the entire U.S. Army, and the entire U.S. Marines under AFRICOM command. And, of course, he's going to turn it into a new Iraq, and he's going to turn it into a new Afghanistan. Everything, every operation that you see going on in Iraq and Afghanistan is going to propagate to the poor countries of Africa.
But they're fighting Joseph Kony, who controls a few hundred square miles and maybe has 500 fighters. I mean, You know, the dictator that the West props up over Uganda, sure, he killed 7 million, but that doesn't matter. There's proof that one little warlord might have been involved in some type of corruption. And remember what the UN has done, the sex trade in Africa, all of it. This whole invisible children thing is just a way to get all the anti-war trendies to get into, hey, let's have a war. And mark my words, all you trendies that support this and support this film, and they may be useful idiots, they may be operatives, I don't know. When it's all done, it'll be in the scholarly publications, but it's going to be there, that millions are going to die if you're successful. So the media and the Hollywood stars and the trendies and the anti-war groups are like, invade Africa, defeat this little warlord, back the genocide leader of Uganda, attack Libya, the blood's on your hands. Just like the communists that supported Lenin and Stalin. Now I want to go ahead and point out to you that Obama is launching all of these wars in Libya, Syria, Central Africa, everywhere, without congressional approval. And our system of checks and balances is in the crapper. This is incredible. With more on that, we go to Webster Griffin Tarpley, who predicted all of this in the Obama deception. Well, you've just seen the tape. 3.5 years ago, Dr. Webster Griffin Tarpley, doctor of history, he's also an economist, predicted this invasion of the continent of Africa via the pretext of humanitarian intervention. And we have seen Libya shattered. He traveled there and was there under the bombardment. First reported months before it came out, the massacre of black Libyans by the Arab al-Qaeda forces brought in. He predicted the attack on Syria using al-Qaeda. That's now happening. And that McCain and others would call for bombardments that are just days or weeks away. Now, I've done a lot of research to be able to cover this subject, but nothing compared to Webster. But what the establishment's planning on doing is more divide and conquer in Africa. And something bigger than the Congo wars that conservatively killed 8 million people or so. You know, you always hear about the Rwandan massacres. That was just one part of a larger constellation of mass murder that went on, all under the UN's auspices. And, of course, you know, earlier I went over a few articles from just last year. We'll talk more about these with Webster in a moment, where they send the UN into Ivory Coast, you name it, slaughtering tens of thousands and admitting they are. And it's almost always Christians. So it's all part of igniting Christian-Muslim infighting. As Tarpley said 3.5 years ago, kicking the Chinese out of the area. They're trying to use development, not military invasion, as a way to get the natural resources. And we see this new Kony 2012. And I'm not saying that Joseph Kony is some wonderful angel. The point is that the larger military that controls the country that he's in, that is fighting against the Lord's Resistance Army in Uganda, is one of the main command bases for AFRICOM to expand the overall destabilization and genocide program that is the official U.S. government policy of State Department Memorandum 200 by Henry Kissinger, saying use war, use famine, use balkanization, use other things to reduce population and industrialization in Africa from 1973. So this is part of a larger strategy or stratagem. And again, I'm not making moral judgments here on the face of it. I'm not saying the Serbs were wonderful angels, but that whole NATO attack and invasion was about balkanizing, bombing infrastructure, controlling drug routes, giving the Muslim extremists control of Albania. Same thing there. But here, they're getting ready for major genocide, and you heard it here first. It's going to be huge. It was earlier today, of course, I got a call from one of the people that works here, a young daughter, a teenager, saying, oh my gosh, you know, there's this Kony 2012. It's had 37 million views in just 3 days. And then, sure enough, I went and researched it. It's this giant call for war. In fact, they have graphics in here on the site saying something that Republicans and Democrats can both agree on. Let's aid the children, because Kony is grabbing them and using them as soldiers. Well, all of Africa does that. The UN does that. The UN's been caught raping them everywhere. The point is, this is part of a larger program. It has nothing to do with the children. Remember, there were the people with Viagra raping the children in Libya? All lies. Saddam throwing babies out of incubators? All lies, admitted. Assad massacres, almost completely exaggerated, with al-Qaeda forces attacking and now caught staging shootings on CNN. This is all blowing up. So it's a pretext, just like I read the quote earlier with William Randolph Hearst, the owner of the Hearst Empire, saying, look, Remington Painter, you supply the paintings, the pictures, I'll supply the war. Okay, so that's what's happening here. And you better believe when they're done getting all the trendies clamoring and the children, you know, the young people, save the children over there. We're children. Of course, they're, again, the propaganda of the Pentagon and the globalists is now targeting American and Western children. They know the adult world's woken up. So now through social networks, all the things they control, Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, the places where we're censored, they are just going in and saying, get behind war, and all these bizarre posters about demand war, demand invasion. And we saw Obama in an exploratory operation, London Telegraph reported on, Obama deploys U.S. Special Forces to Central Africa. That they tried that and they failed. And other investigative reporters that have gone over there to cover this, they die. But these other folks putting out this Kony 2012, they were able to be there for years and get all this useful material. They may be useful idiots, but bottom line, I know packaged propaganda when I see it. And I know the West policy to genocide Africans and to give them those special vaccines where half of them get HIV. So I know the score. When the West wants to help Africa, like Bill Gates and his GMO, look out. Dr. Tarpley, again, I've tried to go over some of this here, but it is mind-blowing to see how they use Twitter, Facebook to overthrow their old dictator in Egypt, and then now things are 10 times worse. To overthrow a guy who'd made deals with him, Gaddafi, now things are 20 times worse. No one debates that. With Assad, I mean, this is order out of KO. You have studied Africa like no one else I know. You've been there many times. You predicted it in the Obama deception. Everything is happening as you said it would. What's really going on here?
Well, I think there are really two sides to this. One is the strategic reality of what the U.S. and the British are doing in Africa. And then there's this viral video, right, from the Invisible Children organization with movie stars and political influentials, and how they're trying to create an actual war hysteria in the American people, which I think can be applied to Africa and also some other places. Let's just take a look at Uganda, which is where this is focused. For the past 25 years or so, since Yoweri Museveni became the dictator of Uganda, and he's a dictator. He's been there for 26 years, right? He's up there with Mubarak and some other people. You never hear that as a complaint, though. He's a great guy. We don't even hear a word about him. Museveni has been the dictator of Uganda since about 1986. And as a result of his rule, which is already with many atrocities and human rights abuses, there's a resistance movement in the northern provinces, which are inhabited by the Acholi people. And that takes this monstrous form of the Lord's Resistance Army under Joseph Kony. And Kony is the figure that is demonized in this film. Now, Kony, one may well say, deserves all the demonization he gets. I think in this case that may well be true. But Kony is not the main story in Uganda, right? Kony has been out of it for several years, as far as I can see, for the last 4 or 5 years. Kony has been nowhere.
Exactly. So to be clear, it's a larger region. We've already had massacres in one case, 7 million, a million in another area, with all these different groups. He's a very minor player. He's just the war hysteria person to be demonized as the pretext for AFRICOM to really pour in and prop up the dictator.
Right. It's a very incongruous choice because he's out there in the bush with a couple of hundred followers. Now, he's undoubtedly got child soldiers. It's undoubtedly hell on earth for the people that are there. But you look at this film and you see, what are their demands? What do they think should happen? These invisible children and the TRI group and their backers, right? Who are their backers? Ocampo, the imperialist stooge who runs the International Criminal Court. He'll indict anybody you want, right? Milosevic, General Bashir of Sudan. How about Bush and Cheney? Ever indict them? Oh, no, not Ocampo. And then we've got a reactionary Republican like Senator Inhofe. Looks like we've got Senator Kerry interested in it. We've got some of these other warmonger hack politicians that we know so well. So the idea, though, is the Ugandan army has to be strengthened. Strengthen the Ugandan army. Are we nuts? The Ugandan army is a party to the biggest genocide in the world since the Second World War, which is the Congo War. The Congo War from the late 90s until, say, the middle of the past decade killed something like 7 or 8 million people, and Uganda invaded Congo and carved out about a third of the country with unbelievable atrocities. So you'd really say between Kony and the Ugandan army, the much bigger war criminal, the wholesalers of genocide, are the Ugandan army and not Kony. Now, this is he would be a retailer, of course, and that's very serious. Uganda has always been the British enforcer, the British U.S. enforcer in this part of the world. I remember visiting Khartoum in the Sudan 15 or more years ago, and the information minister showed me boxes of weapons that had been used to try to foment a rebellion in southern Sudan, right? What you see now as southern Sudan, the area around Juba. And it said, these boxes said, Defense Ministry of Uganda, Kampala, Uganda. So they'd been supporting this. And this entire story of the massacre of the Tutsis in the mid-1990s, Museveni and his group also very much implicated in that story. So if you look at this entire area, it is a horrendous human rights hell on earth, really. In Uganda itself, about 40% of the people live on less than €1 a day. So there's tremendous poverty, right? You'd think they might say something about that. All of these other countries that were involved in that war, and now, of course, new wars are starting up. The common denominator of all these wars, really, is that the U.S. and the British want to drive the Chinese out of Africa, and in particular, this strategically important area, right? This is one of the main concentrations in the world of strategic minerals and strategic raw materials.
Well, mainly rare earth minerals, key things that are needed in electronics. But, yes. But let's expand on that. People say, well, good, America's defending its interests. These are globalists that actually shut down our industry and pay to move it offshore. So they're just using America's muscle. But that's exactly my point. Obviously, this group... this Lord's Resistance Army, from my research, is involved in some criminal activities and some massacres. But it's a tiny, as you said, maximum a few thousand followers, a few hundred soldiers. It's literally a red herring pretext to go in. Same story we've seen, babies incubators, raping the women and children, you know, fueled by Viagra, totally fake, Assad massacres.
Don't forget Gay Girl in Damascus.
Gay Girl in Damascus.
By the way, Bouazizi, when I was just in Iran, I talked to a Tunisian filmmaker. He explained that the whole Bouazizi story, right, the Tunisian fruit vendor, that's a fraud too. So they're all frauds. But it's copper, cobalt, uranium, gold, magnesium, tin, plus these other ones, that molybdenum and these really exotic rare earth elements. So then you go a little bit further south.
But again, let me stop you, Webster, because we need to look at the larger image here. You predicted all of this. They've gone into Libya, wrecked everything, exactly as you said they would. Racial massacres, everything. Where's the Hollywood people on this? Where's the film? Where's the 37 million views in 4 days? You can see the system behind this, who we know wants to genocide in Africa. So, again, the filmmakers may be useful idiots. I just see establishment fingerprints all over this. What's the larger AFRICOM plan? What do they want to do to Africa?
It is to lay waste to the continent, to destroy every independent state, sort of on the Libyan model, right? Libya, the eastern part of Libya has just declared its sort of semi-independence, and that could be a civil war right there.
Al-Qaeda-stan.
Al-Qaeda, Cyrenaica, Benghazi. These places, right? So a terrorist state, the new Barbary Pirates, if you want, on the southern coast of the Mediterranean. Very bad for Europe, very bad for shipping in the Mediterranean. But the general idea is that the Chinese must be kicked out at all costs. And since the Chinese support existing governments wherever they are, whatever they are, the United States and the British have to destroy all the existing governments. And Uganda, Rwanda, and Burundi are key parts of that effort. In other words, they're sort of the indigenous troops. But, of course, there's more. There's also Kenya, right? Obama's ancestral home, where he's got these deals with his cousin Odinga. Somalia, right? There's been military action between Somalia.
So as you said 3.5 years ago, all of Africa, a battlefield on fire. But let's go back, since you were just mentioning, this larger program. For people out there, then, what's the long-term goal?
It is the destruction of every independent state, secessionism, warlords, chaos, right? If you go to the Arab world, as I've found, you hear words from the Bush years that maybe we didn't pay enough attention to. Condoleezza Rice in 2005 began talking about creative chaos. And everybody in the Arab world knew that that meant that their countries were going to be destroyed, split into pieces, or as Brzezinski calls it, Brzezinski has his own term, microstates and mini states. So anybody who's a secessionist, anybody who's a warlord, anybody who wants, rump states or things like this, that's exactly the imperialist program. Now, maybe we go back to the question of the support, though, because you have this group, the Invisible Children, and their TRI fundraising arm. We would have to say that in objective terms, this is functioning as a kind of propaganda arm or cheering section for the U.S. AFRICOM and their desire to partially invade Uganda, but use Uganda, build up Uganda for this task of destroying, as they have to every 10 years or so, destroying all of those countries. If you look at that area on the map, around Lake Victoria, right, the Lakes District of Africa, that's where everything comes together. You got Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Kenya, Somalia.
It's the center of the chessboard strategically.
About a dozen countries, more or less, in that area. But now, from the U.S. point of view, you've got George Clooney. You've got all of these Hollywood characters, right?
The fake liberal fascist.
Yeah, and mushheads and whatever. This is the thing that Obama has been able to do, and this was also another important theme of that book, Obama, the Postmodern Coup. When you had Bush and Cheney after 9/11, Bush was once asked, what should the American people do now that there's this huge terror emergency, which, of course, we know is a fraud? And Bush said, go to the shopping center, go to the mall and buy a bunch of stuff and keep the economy going. There were left liberal warmonger elites that were beside themselves in rage when they heard that. And it's not because they didn't like war. They wanted total war. They wanted more than Bush was able or willing to give them. One of the people here is this Samantha Power. She's now sitting in the White House, right? She's one of the people running the color revolutions across the world. Samantha Power was on the phone with Tantawi and Inan, right, the generals in Egypt, telling them, get Mubarak out, follow orders, you bums, or, you'll be next, and all this stuff. Samantha Power wanted Bush to say, total war, total sacrifice, total mobilization, not go and buy yourself something nice at the mall. And now you see, under Bush and Cheney, it was enough if you were sort of passively supporting imperialism, right? All you had to do was to vote, for Bush, Cheney, neocon candidates.
No, now Obama is arresting hundreds of reporters, Espionage Act, arresting whistleblowers, NDAA, secret arrest of citizens. We're going to censor the web. They march into Congress and say, you don't declare war. UN and NATO does it now. I mean, it is reaching just... But because he's a liberal and because right. He has darker skin, it's like, he could start worshiping Hitler and it'd be okay now. Because it's like, he's liberal. I mean, it's just like, murder everybody. He's liberal.
I would say Mussolini is more up his alley, but we can handle that another time. But you see what he's been able to do. 5 years ago, the campuses where Invisible Children is now recruiting and getting money were hotbeds of anti-war, anti-Bush Cheney, pro-impeachment.
Now they're taking the left over to make them pro-war.
Exactly.
The new anti-war activism is is proxy war, proxy state, civil war, genocide, and the new trendy thing is to support new genocides because there's some phantom guy with 500 followers in the jungle somewhere. Let's kill another 7 mil.
Right, and of course, again, the fact that the International Criminal Court only seems to be interested in people that are black or at least brown is also another giveaway. But now you've got invisible children going on campus and organizing college kids, privileged youth in many ways, to demand war. So this is a huge transition from the passive acceptance of imperialist crimes under Bush Cheney to the active participation. I mean, maybe the next step would be, you know, form an international brigade, send volunteers, who knows what it is, right? But more and more mobilization for aggression, for war, for the imposition of these imperialist policies, and of course, totally mindless. Why is there a crisis in Uganda? Well, they had Idi Amin. Idi Amin was backed by the U.S. and the British as long as he was in power. Then they decided to dump him. Then you had Obote. Then you had a couple of other people in the meantime, and one of them was an Acholi. And then when the Acholi was thrown out, in comes Museveni. Sure. And then the Acholi say, well, then we're going to have to defend ourselves. And that's really the origin of this crazy.
All right, let me stop you right there then. Because let's go back here. I remember seeing documents from the late 40s after World War II when Africa wanted freedom, wanted to throw off colonialism, where they, going back to Prince Philip and, of course, then Queen of the Netherlands' husband, Prince Bernhard, they set up World Wildlife Fund. They set up all these groups, and I've seen the declassified documents. I've covered them, where they, all the way down to the middle of Africa and then over towards the east, down the rift, they got the countries to set up nature preserves, but in some cases that were more than 20% of the countries. But it was contiguous as a green belt, a migration corridor, not for animals and elephants and things and giraffes, but for troops and rebel forces to overthrow countries that didn't play ball. So they play both ends. They play the rebels, but they also play the governments that work with them, all part of an overall strategy of destabilization. How does that tie into it, and how are things going for the New World Order? I mean, you've been to Iran recently, you've been to Libya, you've been to Syria, I mean, you've been everywhere, you've witnessed it. How is the overall program going for them with the Russians vetoing, the UN program to go into, I mean, they're already doing it through proxies, but to do it with airstrikes, part two of Libya in Syria. So now they're saying, well, we'll just go it alone. I mean, how are things going for them? But first, the use of nature corridors as rebel force bases.
Well, that's, of course, the founders of the World Wildlife Fund, Prince Philip and Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands. Let's remember, Prince Bernhard of the Netherlands was actually a German nobleman who was officially, on paper, card-carrying member of the Nazi SA, the brown shirts, the Sturmabteilung, and of the black-shirted SS, where he was part of the noble, aristocratic branch, right? The Reiter SS. So that's Bernhard. So they after World War II, they discovered that the way to go is radical ecologism. And as you say, they built up all of those nature parks. And a lot of times the nature parks were astride borders. In other words, there'd be a nature park on one side, and then on the other side of the border, some other country, there'd be another nature park. And it meant that the smuggling routes could go through these parks, and Philip and Bernhard could get their cut. Philip, of course, is somebody who's got a whole history of collaboration in that sense back in his biography, which we didn't hear about when we had the royal wedding this past summer. So that's one thing. Now, obviously, today you need different methods. They've gone through this huge war in this area around the lakes, around Congo. Congo, of course, very important. Katanga province has the minerals. Zimbabwe in the south, you'll be hearing about them too, right? The U.S. and the British still want to get the government of Zimbabwe overthrown, right? Mugabe is their enemy because Mugabe is, whatever he is, he's stable and he deals with the Chinese. And similarly for these other countries. So I think you can assume right now that there are U.S. troops and U.S. drones flying in all of those places. I mean, they're not going to respect borders in that area. So
the White House has said that. They'll kill anybody, anywhere in the world, more than 20,000 drones operating, killing 24/7, and they say they'll kill citizens here with them if they want.
All right, now, in terms of the big picture, the Anglo-Americans are apoplectic because they have been blocked. Putin is now the president-elect of Russia, and Putin, after this prolonged period of appeasement and weakness that we had with Medvedev, Putin has taken a clear stand, I think.
Let me stop you. So Medvedev was not just a placeholder for Putin. I mean, what's your evidence of that? Because they were little buddy boys.
Yeah, look, at that level of power, there's no such thing as a close personal friendship, really, because as soon as you had the entire imperialist world, right, the U.S., the British, the continental European puppet states, all of them piling in favor of Medvedev, it meant that Medvedev had power, and he's responsible.
And he had the hamburger summit, so you think he bought into it?
Degraded. Look, that's why the ruling parties lost the election in early December. Putin was not on the ballot. Medvedev was. Medvedev of hamburger diplomacy, cavorting with Obama, fawning on Gates and Jobs and these ripoff artists of Silicon Valley. The average Russian is just disgusted by that. So, thank goodness, Michael McFaul, the guy who ran the destabilization of Egypt, among other things, Michael McFaul was sent as the U.S. ambassador to Moscow in January. His task was throw together, improvise a color revolution. They called it the White Revolution. Inside the country, it was called the Orange Revolution. I had a chance to talk to a very interesting Russian by the name of Maxim Shevchenko. It's very interesting. On one day in the first week of February, there was an anti-Putin demonstration of about 50,000 people in Moscow, and that there was a demonstration of 150,000 people at Victory Park, Poklonaya Hill, outside Moscow, that was addressed by this guy Shevchenko and some others. It was three times bigger. The U.S. media didn't report that, and this was pro-Putin, but critically pro-Putin. It was not, you know, blank check for
Putin.
But
let me stop you for a minute. I had Colonel Anthony Schaefer, who's, you know, high-level intelligence connections, and he said, A, these wars are illegal, are treason, and went over the evidence, but he also said yes. And he said a lot of folks in the Pentagon say, leave Russia alone. They're not trying to be expansionist. Why mess with them? Why poke them? And that a lot of Pentagon folks think messing with Russia will make them actually get behind hardliners. So again, when the Pentagon's speaking out, or sources are, what's the stratagem then to mess and poke with Russia? Because history shows Russia only unifies when it's under attack, and that this isn't going to work. And then the West admitted they're trying to do a color revolution and disrupt their elections over there. I mean, it's, and it obviously didn't work.
Yeah, the word orange, right? Orange means the Kiev color revolution of 2004. Orange in Russian is bad. It's like, you know, yellow, right? It's a bad color to be. So there was an anti-orange movement. The thing with Russia now is Russia has drawn a red line around Syria, as far as I can see. Medvedev refused to draw a red line around Libya, although he could have. And the ambassador Chamov said to him, you're a traitor. And this guy Shevchenko that I'm telling you about went on Russian state television and said, Medvedev has committed a crime. And Shevchenko was fired. Well, now Shevchenko is back, so he's on Moscow television most nights. So the idea is the only thing, and it's the only thing, stopping the U.S., the British, NATO, and the Israelis from launching an attack on Syria and Iran is the fact that Putin is back. The Russians have sent their fleet to Tartus, right? The port. I've seen the port.
And the Russian stock market's up.
Well, the Russians have also delivered, we believe, these S-300 surface-to-air missiles, probably the most capable system in the world. The Russians are providing intelligence, right? They help along with the electronic monitoring and the radar stations and so forth. So if you attack Syria, this is not the cakewalk that the Anglo-Americans like to have, and I believe this is what's stopping them. So the fact that Putin has been reelected, I must say, is the best thing that's happened in the world in quite a while. But I think he needs to do more. I'm not here just to say, you know, go Putin, but he needs to take some important steps. We're on the verge of a war in the Middle East. We've got to have an initiative for a Middle East peace conference or something of that type. Putin right now is the most prestigious leader in the world, bar none, in the broad world, right? Not in the world of CBS News, maybe, but out there in the real world, yes. What he needs to do is to take that political capital and use it. Let's have a general peace conference, right? The Israelis say they feel threatened. I'm sure they do. How about the Iranians? They feel threatened, too. Go to the table. Lebanon needs to be
rebuilt. Well, I know you like Putty-Poo, but I watched him go along with all these other wars. You know, very corrupt system over there as well. I'm asking you, how are things...
That's not even the question.
How are things going in the... But let's expand. Euro is in the middle of this, collapsing, but into this global banker receivership of fraud. They're openly butchering the Bill of Rights publicly in the United States. What's the larger global order? I mean, you're saying that the Anglo-American banker establishment is freaking out. Why are they freaking out? Where do you see things going?
Well, the derivative castle, right? The house of cards of $1.5 to $2 quadrillion of bankrupt, kited, insolvent derivatives. This is permanently on the brink, right? And their demand is always increase the looting rate, increase the rate of exploitation in the third world. And if governments get in the way, as they necessarily do, smash the governments. So right now, though, I think we can look at it internationally. If you look at the UN General Assembly in that vote on the anti-Syria resolution of about 2.5-3 weeks ago now, there were 12 no votes. Well, that was Russia, China, Iran, Syria, Venezuela, and their group, the ALBA group.
But those didn't count. I mean, only the Security Council votes counted of Russia and China.
Wait. I'm trying to show you the way the world is going. 12 no votes. There were 17 abstentions, some important countries there. And then there were 30 countries that just didn't show up, right? The Philippines. They just didn't show up. The heat was too great. They wanted to vote no or yes, but they couldn't take the heat. So there are about 60 countries, one-third of the world, that despite the most intense arm-twisting blackmail, bribery, and whatever else, were not supporting the imperialist resolution against Syria. Now, that's a sign of the times. Once you've said Russia, China, that's half the world, right? The biggest country geographically, biggest country demographically, Iran, leading Muslim state, Venezuela, leading South American state, go through the list, right? All kinds of countries that could not see their way to support this monstrosity. So I think that's a real change. One third of the world is not playing ball with the Anglo-Americans in some way.
Well, I want to be clear. The Anglo-Americans are not pro-America. They're not pro-Europe. They're not pro-liberty. In closing,
right.
Euro, open world government run by private banks, all being announced, everything else that's happening over there, admissions that we're going into a deeper depression, long-term view, where's all this going?
Well, again, you always say take the subjective factor out, and I can't because, you know, some of us are here and you're here and we're all here. I think what you need is a movement to break the power of finance capital, and that's to break the power of Wall Street finance capital, and I think that could emerge at any point. There's certainly plenty of masses in motion in Europe. Here in the United States, we've got all kinds of struggles going on against the fascist governors of the Midwestern states. Let's take Michigan, right? If you don't like dictatorship, you're not going to like Governor Snyder of Michigan because he's got a law where he says he can become the dictator of Detroit and Flint and Grand Rapids and Traverse City and all those places in Michigan. He can be the dictator. As soon as he says you're bankrupt, I'm taking you over, I'm sending in a commissar who's going to rule you by decree. So you're talking about wiping out democracy.
Yeah, let me add a caveat to that. It's not just Michigan. Rhode Island's doing it all over. This is the third world model where they induce you into fraud. The state signs you on to the derivatives. And then they're coming in and taking control and saying no more city council or the city council can be administrative. I mean, this is corporate takeover.
Yes, I think that's the cutting edge of the struggle against dictatorship inside this country. And again, those blue collar workers out in the Midwest. The funny story, you know, you go overseas and they say, tell us about Occupy Wall Street. It started in September, right? And I say, no, it started with the occupation of Madison, Wisconsin, back in February.
Sure, but the system co-opted that. But Webster, let me throw on.
It didn't. That's what the system tried to suppress, and then they give you this substitute, right, which is the petty bourgeoisie and the lumpen proletariat in the form of Occupy Wall Street with David Graeber and the Adbusters Institute, right? This is not what you need. Obviously, you need those people too, but not those leaders. So it seems to me you've got a mass strike process going on. You've got the ingredients there. You need what you always needed, program, leadership, some kind of organization, and some kind of strategy. And at that point, you could make rapid progress.
All right, so I understand. I don't know if I subscribe to all those government solutions because it always gets taken over by a bunch of criminals.
I'm talking about mass struggle. I'm talking about the only possible way to go. I'm afraid we look at the presidential campaign. I don't see how anybody could go into it. I mean,
that's a pretty much decided thing more and more between Obama and Mitt Romney. We're going to discuss that at a future date, but we're out of time here. I want to ask you about the fact of Congress, who's been pro-war, pro-tyranny, pro-torture, pro-every form of corruption you can imagine, is now getting mad that Obama and SecDef Panetta and the rest of them are telling him, hey, we're going to launch wars without you now. You don't even matter. And Congress is finally freaking out. And they're saying our authority is these international bodies themselves that are controlled by the central banks, the UN, NATO, groups like this. Why do you think the system's racing to put in a classical tyranny here in the United States?
Well, this is obviously the motor force comes from the economic breakdown crisis. In other words, the fact that the capital structures of New York and London are collapsing pushes them to demand, again, more loot, more exploitation, more sacking, downward pressure on the standard of living, bust all the unions, tear up the contracts, destroy the social safety net, use the proceeds for new and better bailouts, new and better subsidies for the rich and super rich. So that's the motor force that's doing it. But of course, that can very well provoke countervailing social movements, right? That the history of the 20th century is that a super austerity policy will lead to a social explosion. And the big question then is, who's going to lead the social explosion? Will somebody be there with leadership, or are you going to get Adbusters, David Graeber, Michael Moore, Noam Chomsky, and others that guarantee absolute defeat?
Controlled opposition.
Right, sure.
Controlled left, controlled right.
If it's controlled, it controlled means it's going to be destroyed. I have to say, with Occupy Wall Street, when you look at this now from retrospectively, the anarchists who took over Occupy Wall Street had really one program. They wanted to have a hippie commune in the park with no demands, no nothing, nothing political. They said, we're going to start living the new utopia, right? We're going to live the new world that we want in the park. And no demands, right? They're not going to do anything for working people. Not
sure,
for
but
blacks.
That's not even as bad as the new liberal calls for wars because there's some boogeyman off in the bushes there in Central Africa. Webster, Tarpley.net, author. Look forward to having you on the radio soon.
Thank you.
Thank you for spending time with us.
Good luck, Alex. See you soon.
We're going to go to break. Let me say bye to you during the break. Wow. I mean, love him or hate him, his overall analysis is spot on, and he's been all over the world. I got to get him back on about his trip to Iran. He also went to Syria. This guy has a lot of courage. And certainly what he's talking about with AFRICOM and this invasion is so real. We're going to come back and talk about the TSA didn't just block the video of an engineer exposing the fact that their scanners are a fraud and don't stop bombs. They're now telling members of the press, you don't talk to this guy if you know what's good for you. You don't talk to the press in America. This is land of the slave, home of the coward, New World Order Central. Well, we're extremists. We think in America there is a press, there is free speech. I'm sorry, I apologize. I believe there should be due process as well. I believe that you have a right to visit Infowars.com, and if you believe in what we're doing, become a subscriber at PrisonPlanet.tv. We have 15-day free trials running right now. We'll be right back after this quick break with our next guest. He's the guy that runs the website TSA Out of Our Pants.
One is a serial hypocrite who lobbied for Freddie Mac before the housing crisis and for the individual mandate before Obamacare. another, a counterfeit conservative who opposes right to work, massively increased spending, and funded Planned Parenthood. Finally, a flip-flopper who's been on all sides, supported TARP bailouts, and provided the blueprint for Obamacare. Three men, one vision, more big government, more mandates, less freedom. One man stands apart, ready to deliver real change, voting against every tax increase and every unbalanced budget every time. A real plan to cut $1 trillion year one and to balance the budget in three. Pro-life, pro-liberty, guided by faith and principle. Ron Paul, the one who will restore America now.
I'm Ron Paul, and I approve this message.